My goodness, Anduin is such a punk. Welcome to another episode of Allcraft. My name is Rich, and I am joined by Hodded and Asmongold. And back on the show after, I feel like you were like the second or third episode.
It's been a while, dude.
Yeah.
It's been like a year since I've last been here, yeah.
Welcome the hell back, man. It's nice to have you back.
It feels good, but I just want to get something out of the way right as we start. That promo picture on Twitter, which one of you guys picked that? Because that was not me.
So what happens is that I get it like commissioned to do because I'm not a good graphic designer, and the graphic designer thought that it would be cool to get you. Yeah, you look good. It's okay.
Give me the name of that graphic designer. I don't know about that.
But I thought it was funny.
Is that picture not you?
No, it's me, but it's just...
Oh, okay.
It's from like a year ago, and I don't know, I look like a douchebag or something.
No, you don't. You look beautiful.
Like a douchebag or something.
Wait, am I allowed to cuss? Am I allowed to cuss on here?
Yeah. I just thought that was a funny curse word. It wasn't a standard one. It's like poop bag, you know? It's like, you didn't see that coming. But, yo, so let's jump right into it and talk about the thing that we talk about way too much because it's finally changing, GCD. Racials and Trinkets going to be off the GCD on the next beta build. This is a good thing.
Here's what Blizzard does. Is they start it off and they tell you that they're going to cut off your entire arm. And then you're like, wow, that sounds terrible. Oh my god, this is awful. I don't know if I'm going to play the expansion. And then they're like, okay, you know what? We're only going to cut off all five of your fingers. And it's like, oh wow, okay, Blizzard's not really that bad. And then they're like, well, you know what? Just to make it better, to show that we really care and we understand the community, we're only going to cut off three of them. And then before you know it, Blizzard cuts off your finger and you say, thanks. You know? Come on, man. Like, just get rid of the chain. Nobody wants this shit.
I agree, partially. I will say that this is definitely a move in the right direction, but at the same time, moving some of the abilities to the GCD may work. Moving a few. Having the overall thing, having a bunch of abilities go to the GCD just doesn't make sense at all. Trinkets definitely don't make sense. Racials don't make sense. I think the bigger problem is just the way that certain classes are made. It's the cooldowns that are the problem. It's not necessarily the way that they interact with the GCD that's the problem. And if they start to look at it that way, awesome. But Zarya, you haven't been on the show in a while. Let's get the PvP perspective. What did you actually think about the change that was happening on beta?
I think it slows everything down. I know they've kind of brought up some counterpoints. It's like, doesn't really slow down gameplay. It just gives people time to react. But if you put like more spells on GCD, if you look at it like the opposite way, you take everything off GCD, the game's going to be really, really, really fast. If you put more things on GCD or make the GCD longer, the game slows down. If you put the global to 2 seconds instead of 1 second, the game slows down. So having more things on GCD is just going to slow the game down, which I'm not a huge fan of. I kind of see why they're doing it. I had a question for you too, though. You said some things I would like to see on GCD. What's an example of that? Like, why? Like, what would you actually want to see on GCD? Because Icy Veins being on global cooldown doesn't feel great, you know?
Yeah, the more of what I was going for is I feel like there is actually a problem there. This maybe isn't actually the solution.
Okay.
It's kind of a scuffed Band-Aid, to be honest. Right. But the fact that every single toolkit is the same across the board, everybody has all these cooldowns, it always seems like the right situation to stack up all of these cooldowns at the same time. It shouldn't be that way. If you end up using the GCD in a certain way where, like, maybe you see one class stagger their cooldowns, I could say maybe that's an interesting change. Maybe. But at the end of the day, I think the problem itself isn't being touched at all. I don't really think that it's a good change.
So personally for me, what I've always liked to see, cooldowns interact with each other. So the classic example I use is Mage and Mist of Pandaria. If I wanted to burst someone, I had to, you know, press Encanter's Ward, right? This was mana shield and it had to be broken, and then I'd get a 10 or 15% damage increase. I had to wait for my proc trinket. I had to use my unused trinket. I had to use Icy Veins. I had to use my Pet Nova to get the freeze damage modifier. I had to use Living Bomb into that Pet Nova for the Living Bomb to start taking damage. I had to do like six different things before I even pressed my first damaging ability. Now what do I do is I just Icy Veins Orb.
Yeah, it's like instead of like adding a GCD, make like a GCD from your mind. Like, okay, these are the steps I have to do to maximize my damage, and you go through your sequence, and you can always change or alter the sequence if you want. But obviously, to get the max out of it, you have to do it the way you described, for example.
Well, how do you feel, Zaryu, about, like, because one of the things that could happen, the big problem is, first of all, is if you look at the way that cooldowns work currently, and if this change happens, all of a sudden you use your massive cooldown ability, you go to sit on the target and deal damage, and by the time you can actually deal damage from putting a CC onto the target, activating your cooldown, your two GCDs in, you lose a lot of uptime, sure. And that's where the whole thought process of maybe it's easier to react to comes in. Is that the correct way to look at it? Probably not. But what do you think about having certain CC on the GCD in PvP so there is actually that moment where a healer can go, okay, I need to put out this external cooldown to try to keep this person safe. Do you think that is a good change, allows people to react, or do you think it removes the skill ceiling?
Like, what CC are we talking about here? Because, like, most CCs that I have seen are, like, already on GCD, like polymorph.
Yeah, like Hammer of Justice or, like, Mortal Coil or what?
I'm saying if they did it across the board, because that's what they're trying to do, right?
So, I mean, obviously, I think that some CC should be instant, but there should always be, like, a difference between instant and casted CC, where casted CC was much more severe, it would last longer, and instant CC would be much shorter and less important. I think that's kind of what would make sense. Sorry, what do you think about that?
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. Like, right now, we have a lot of things on GCD, and then a couple things off, and yeah. I think that's okay. As far as, like, class design, I'm on beta right now on my Rogue, and I actually kind of like how they're doing sub-Rogue right now. So there's a lot of things off GCD. We have Shadow Dance still off of Global. We have Symbols of Death still off of Global. Both modify your damage. And then we have something like Cold Blood that's on Global, and that doesn't bother me as much because you can pre-activate Cold Blood, right? You can pre-activate it when you're in stealth, and you can kind of premeditate that Global instead of having it taking a Global in your burst rotation, if that makes sense. So, like, it's not like, oh, I'm going to kidney shot someone and then pop Cold Blood where it does nothing for Global. It's supposed to power me up. If you can preemptively pop it, then I think that's okay. But I think something like a Shadow Dance being on Global would feel awful, but it's not, so I'm happy about that.
It's like empowering a spell, right? Cold Blood makes, like, what is it, like, your next attack crit? I forgot.
10% total health of the target is reduced. Okay. Yeah, so yeah, really good.
I don't know, like, has anything changed class-wise for rogues or mages? Because I feel like I went to my druid, like, 2 days ago and played, like, and streamed some WoW. I know, right, guys? Streaming WoW. But anyways.
You were playing WoW?
I know, dude.
You don't do that.
We're back, baby. According to chat. I went to try out my Moonkin. It felt everything was the same. I finally got full moon back. God bless. and then, yeah, no changes for, like, maybe. So, it's not implemented or something like that?
I think, let me see if I screenshot it. Cdu actually tweeted something that I thought was really sad, but kind of accurate. I didn't, so I'm actually going to just look up the tweet right now. But basically,
is this the patch?
Yeah, he basically said that the expansion feels like I already got it. Honor Talents finally came out on BFA. From what I saw, there are barely any new talents. There's a spelling error there. A few recycled ones from artifacts or other specs, but nothing new. As it stands now, I won't be getting a single new ability moving into the new expansion, Legion 2.0, without artifacts. I think that's a really important thing to talk about. We already started to talk about the GCD, and Zaryu, the main reason I wanted to get your opinion on it is it ever the right thing in PvP? I think with our other guests kind of said, it doesn't really have much of an upside in PvE. Will it have one in PvP? It looks like situationally, maybe there are some areas that make sense, but across the board, hell fucking no. So you start talking about class design. Rogues seem good. I've heard every single mage start to complain. Let's start with mages. It is basically your bread and butter spec, your bread and butter class. How do you actually feel about mages class design wise in BFA? And then we'll move from there.
Okay, so Frost and Arcane feel like you have a bunch of random spells that don't synergize with each other. They're plopped on the class and you just have like 10 different buttons to press randomly. They have no synergy with each other, and I don't get excited when I spec, oh, let me spec this and then this, and they work together to do more damage. Like on my sub rogue, you know, 40% more damage here, 20% more damage here. I'm going to add this up to 100% damage and one-shot someone. That feels great. Right? On my Shadow Priest, same type of thing. I have a lot of spells that work in conjunction and, you know, kind of end up with a cool class design. But on my Frost Mage, it's just like, I have Ray of Frost, which is just a 4-second channel that one-shots people. I have Ebon Bolt, which is a, you know, a 45-second cooldown that one-shots people. And I have Comet Storm and Ice Nova. Like, what's my rotation? Frostbolt? That doesn't do anything. I just have a bunch of cooldowns that don't really do anything.
They one-shot people. Yeah. That's better than Fury Warrior. All my cooldowns don't do shit.
Okay, well, I guess what I'm talking about here is not viability. So everyone in the chat right now is probably like, shut up, Czar, mages are OP. Yo, just to defend myself, I'm not talking about viability. I'm talking about how the class feels, how it plays, and how the spells interact with each other.
So what you're saying is that it feels really clunky right now.
It feels very extremely clunky on Frost and Arcane. Now, I've played a little bit of Fire, and then Fire seems like a different story. It still seems like it has some spells that work together. It's like, okay, I'm going to combo two Critical Strikes, get a Pyro Blast, throw out the Pyro. If it crits, you know, throw another Fire Blast or another Pyro. It feels kind of good. It feels kind of like the spells work together. Frost just feels so counterintuitive. It feels like everything's fighting each other. It feels like there's no synergy built within the spells. It just feels very clunky. That's my initial impression.
Mugen just feels the same but slower, literally.
Well, let's take that a step further, right? Feels clunky. Do you agree with what Cedu tweeted?
Let me just say something. I was playing today, and I said on stream, I was like, give me a minute, I'm popping my cooldowns. You know, and I wasn't like, no, that was actually what I needed to do. I needed to, all right, you know, I could go through one of them. All right, let's go through the next one. Okay, let's go to the next one. All right, now finally, oh, no, now first one's gone. Okay, never mind.
Yeah. That's so stupid. Oh, man.
Not good.
Jesus, save us.
I think specifically with Warrior, it's like worst case scenario. Because with Warrior, it's
just you're like just running around, just like strafing, waiting for it.
This is exactly what I'm trying to get to with not everything be homogenized, right? Not everything should be homogenized. Warrior is the Swifty one-shot spec. Like, that is what Warrior, like, it doesn't need to be the same for every Warrior spec, but it is fine to have a class that overlaps a bunch of cooldowns. It's fine to have a class that has no fucking cooldowns. Stop trying to make these blanket statements and design the goddamn class. And getting back to that, Czar, you talk about it feels clunky. That's obviously a problem. Cedu brings up this issue on Twitter of the fact that it doesn't feel like you're getting any new spells. Is that something that you felt on Mage as well?
Yeah, so something that we've seen in every single expansion is at least one new ability. Now, we don't have our artifact necklaces yet, and I think there might be some abilities within the PvP gear we're getting as well. So that might still be the case. But I think I could be wrong there. Don't quote me on that. I think I was reading something about that. But
okay.
So we might still get abilities there. But so far, we don't have a single new ability, which feels just weird for a new expansion because you log into Legion and you're playing. You're like, oh, look, I got beta. Let me log into beta. And you might have one or two less spells and maybe like one returning spell. So you have one or two total like net less spells and one returning spell. So all in all, you're just like, wait a minute. This is the new expansion or like some, you know, it just doesn't feel right without getting a new ability.
And we have to keep reminding ourselves the expansion is 3 months away, like literally the launch date.
Somebody said something to me the other day. I forget who it was. It was like Sloot, I think. And I said something because somebody said something about pre-patch. It may have even been on last week's episode of Allcraft. I don't know. All the days are blending into each other. But like Sloot said something was like, yeah, it's probably like a month or so away. It's like, holy shit. Pre-patches
in 2 months.
And pre-patch usually has all of your new, like, it basically changes your spec so it would be that spec without the new abilities that you gain as you level up. But apparently that's not a thing anymore because leveling's a vestigial organ. I really don't understand. These classes are pretty much, they should be shippable at this point. I don't know.
It's a huge problem because one of the things in my case, for example, I covered a lot of Warlords of Draenor. I covered a lot of Legion Alpha and Beta. And one of the main things is that all the different changes, how the class feels, you try to kind of like explore and make content ideas for videos. And in Legion, it's just like new dungeons, raid test, maybe what the developers say. But as far as like testing out new abilities, new rotations, like how much you need to burst.
There used to be like, I think it was like Michael Hogman, cartoons. He did all these videos about dueling in Mists of Pandaria, and people love those videos, right?
Yeah.
Like, I feel like that kind of stuff is not really as interesting now because there hasn't really been that many changes. Also, I'm not a big fan of doing stat switches every other expansion, I'll be honest, especially whenever I see them. The numbers creeping right back up to Warlords of Draenor level. And it's very frustrating.
like I feel like this is the swing. It's we're in their upswing, and if they don't capitalize on this, then
I hate the idea of thinking that Legion, like Legion has its own problems, but I really don't want Battle for Azeroth to make me appreciate Legion.
I already appreciate Legion. I'm going
to
say that.
I'll have to agree with you there a little bit. Yeah.
More than I do. Okay?
Yeah, I thought Legion was amazing.
Legion was a great fucking expansion.
There were good things about it.
Better than Warlords. Yeah,
exactly. That was what I was about to say. It's just like in the same breath, like a big part of kind of what you're saying is we'll always have that with Wad, right? Like Wad is always going to be the worst girlfriend we've ever had in our entire life. She was boring and she tried to kill us. No, it's like it's one of those things where it's like, and she's fucking okay. So the thing is,
I agree. Honestly, like I feel like Legion is definitely better than Mists of Pandaria. I liked it more than Mists of Pandaria, at least. Like, I mean, obviously, this is all subjective, but I feel like it's obviously better than Mists of Pandaria, and maybe better than Cataclysm in a lot of regards. I kind of prefer Cataclysm. That might be nostalgia, though. Definitely better than WoD. So Legion in general has been a good expansion. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, has it been great? Like, are there things that I hate about it? Yeah, of course, and you guys know what they are, so I don't even need to go over them. But Battle for Azeroth, like, going into it, I want to make sure, and I just feel like, you know, losing the abilities, losing the artifact weapon, which I'm okay with, but I feel like they've tried to do so many things to make things, like, very, very streamlined and less, just like very easy to get into. Like there's no depth to them at all. And it's kind of boring to me. And a lot of the things like Warfronts are an example, right? I did Warfronts today. And it's another example of there is no lose condition for Warfronts, really.
Can you give a quick explanation of like how you felt it and like...
Warfronts. About Warfronts. I love them. I like them a lot. I think that the idea of Warfronts was really cool. I think they can iterate on them and develop them a lot more than they have, and I expect and look forward to seeing that. But one of the big problems that I have with Warfronts right now is that, and this is the same thing with a lot of things, is that there's no real lose condition, right? You either win fast or you win slower, but either way, you win. And this isn't like a participation trophy situation. This isn't either you win or you win. It's the same as LFR.
Yeah, fuck LFR. And just kidding, I love LFR. But let me build on that really quick, because I think it goes further, right? If you look at vanilla, everything, there were a lot of places where you couldn't lose, right? There were a lot of places where you still couldn't lose if you just played really hard, right? If you sucked, but you grinded rep for a really long time, it may take you twice as long, but you would still get it. In the process of doing that, you tended to get better. That was a large way. That's kind of how MMOs used to work, right? The grind, you could supplement being a shitbag by playing a lot, and that made you good some of the time. Sometimes you just stay shitty. But that was kind of the win-win condition, was eventually you're going to get good at this game if you keep playing it.
I agree with you, and I think that's a very, very interesting point. And the distinction that I would draw is that I feel like before in vanilla and like those other win fast or win slow conditions, the difference between that and now is that the conditions now were engineered by the game, whereas before they were kind of placed there and you could do them at your own speed. And if you were faster, you did them faster. And if you were slower, you did them slower. And now they're much more pronounced and much more directly engineered and developed by the developers.
I totally agree. I think that the latter is a lot better. Second, I want to say, everybody say hi to McConnell Red. He's in chat right now. Hi, McConnell. The other big thing to focus on is the fact that all of a sudden the attention span that is getting catered to is very different, right? It is all about instant gratification. That's the problem.
They're catering it to people that like they get bored halfway through a Vine video.
Vine didn't even last. Vine was too long for it to last with the current.
Like 8 seconds. What do you have all day for this? Come on.
I am totally fine with things like Warfronts existing and being a win-win scenario, but the awards can't be too prestigious inside of the game, because let's be honest, they're never going to be that prestigious inside of your soul. Let me get this one, because the thing is the reward systems, regardless of what you earned, mattered because of how hard you had to work for them, because of the goals that you put on the self, because of you as the player, and that's what made WoW such a goddamn good thing. It was actually what was going on internally and with the friends that you made in the game. Now, I don't give a fuck about honor tokens. I don't give a goddamn about the loot that I get that doesn't Titanforge or Titanforges. The internal things aren't there as much to make that. These virtual things that don't matter, matter. Because they used to matter because of how you got them.
Well, it's what they mean, right? It's like whenever you saw somebody in the city with a lot of really good gear, it wasn't really the numbers. It was kind of everything that those numbers mean, right? That means that this person is good enough to be part of a guild, to be part of an organization, to be able to work their way up, and to be able to be so valuable to that organization that they felt like it was worth it to give that person full tier through in Thunder Fury, right? Like, that kind of stuff is amazing. And that's why it meant so much. It wasn't the numbers at all. It's what those numbers mean. And I feel like that's a level that people don't really draw. You know, they look at, you know, okay, somebody plays a lot and, you know, they're really good at the game and they have these really good numbers. But what people are really inspired by, and I think that's kind of like an odd word to use, but what people really are motivated by and they think is really cool is what those numbers and what that stuff actually means, what that means that person put into the game. And nowadays, we have so many things that are either, you know, basically guaranteed, or participation rewards, like, okay, you do 10,000 world quests, you get some kind of item, or paragon boxes, you just get lucky. Those things don't matter. And it doesn't matter how many of them they put in the game and what they look like or what they do. They don't mean anything, because what people see is just somebody who either spent a whole lot of time on something or somebody who is just lucky. And luck is not, you can envy somebody with luck, but you don't aspire to be lucky.
Yeah, so
that's a great way to put it.
This is said by someone in chat, and I want to call it out because it's funny that their name's Poetic Mix-Up. This is so poetic. Poetic Mix-Up says, your gear used to tell a story. And I totally agree with that.
Okay.
The whole thing with Titanforging is it doesn't really tell a story. It's this random thing.
Vegas,
yeah,
baby!
And hell yeah, baby. That's happening soon. That's happening real soon. But I actually just got back an hour ago. But sorry, I kind of want to lean on you with this too, because you've played at the highest level in PvP. You played the game for a very long time. Do you feel like now there has been a big fulcrum shift between excitement with rewards because of the random things that happens? Because there's definitely a level of excitement there. When you get a legendary, even if it's shit, there's that level of excitement. Heart rate jumps up, kind of like mine is now because I'm yelling for no reason, compared to feeling good and feeling completed, feeling satisfied, because that's how it used to feel, at least in my mind, when you got a piece of gear. You may not have been excited because you knew you were going to get it this week if it dropped, but there was just that long-lasting thing that lasted when you went into school the next day and you looked at all the normies around you, they had no idea how good you were, and you were just like, yes.
I bet they don't have the tier 2 helmet, dude, but I do.
When I was a middle schooler, I had a bunch of friends that played WoW, and I was level 60 back in vanilla, and they were level like 20s running around Duskwood. I wouldn't even talk to them. I'd be like, get to level 60 before you even talk to me.
Man. Just above them,
dude. You were so cool. I was just starting playing, and I remember the guy who was level 60. He was one of my classmates. He always treated me like scum. He's like, what are you talking about? You're level 39. Just don't talk to me. I'm like, what the? Come on, man. I just wanna. I don't know.
Side note. A couple of those guys are still some of my best friends till today. So something stuck. But I don't know. Anyway, back to the gear. I think in Legion, for PvP at least, the legendary number 1 through 5 might have been cool, but I know like my 12th, 15th, 20th legendary, I didn't even blink. I was like, oh, another legendary, I guess. I don't need it for item level, so I'm just going to put it in my bank where all the rest of them go. So that's really lackluster. I think for me as a PvPer, I agree with like the story statement that someone said in the chat. But above all, I think the classic example is like back in Burning Crusade and Wrath of the Lich King a little bit, when you got your 2K shoulders, you know, your 2200 shoulders in season 4, 2K shoulders in season 3, 1800 helm or whatever. Yeah. I mean, I remember when I was 14 or 15 years old, I remember where I was. I remember, you know, what I ate that day, what I was wearing. Like, that was the biggest moment of my life to get those 2200 shoulders, put them on and walk around fucking Ironforge. I felt like a king. just to wear shoulders because everyone else. I was right. But nowadays it's just like I see someone with good gear. You know, I might look at like someone who has full Titan Forge 975 arena pieces. I'm like, damn, that guy's lucky. You know, like that's just the difference right there. I want to see someone that. And then BFA, I think they're adding this. I did a tweet about it, like, but I'm really excited about it. But there's going to be tiers of gear based on rating, and it's going to increase or something. Hopefully it's better than a linear fashion.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because, like, if you look at the amount of difference between, like, a, let's say, item level 850 player versus an item level 950 player, it's only 10%, right? Yeah. It is 10%. The fair difference between somebody who has the best gear in the game and somebody who has the worst gear in the game. I don't think so. I feel like the difference should be much more pronounced. I'm not saying you should be able to one-shot people like in World PvP. No. But at the same time, there's a lot of gray area. And I feel like right now, the reward for having very good gear in PvP is non-existent. And because of that, people don't really care about getting good gear. And what's going to happen whenever they removed the stat templates is people are just going to get gear with their two best main stats on it and not worry about the item level. Obviously, the item level will be important, but it won't actually be defining just by the way that secondary stats work in the first place. So I feel like this entire problem that Blizzard has created is predicated on the false assumption that players want to be in a fair, completely fair and completely balanced experience. I think that if people wanted that, they would play a game that already provided that for the past 10 years. People that play WoW play it because they like the idea of character progression and working at something and then being more powerful than other people. And the stat templates and the stat equalization and everything like that, it just directly contradicts that.
Just as a quick side note on the stat templates, I'm still at the end of Legion having people in my chat daily being like, oh, does item level matter in PvP more or do stats matter? And you can just call them a noob or something, but the fact that that's not listed somewhere in the game and it's not available for every player to see that, that's you know, true. 1% for every 10 item levels, I think that's ridiculous. Like, people still don't know that and they're going for stats. They're like, oh, I'm going to go for a haste build. Like, oh, I wonder why I don't feel like I'm casting any faster when I stacked full haste gear. That needs to be fixed, or it needs to be just in PvP, and very obvious that it's just item level. If that's what they want to do.
Do you guys know if the stat template's coming, like it's coming back for BFA? Or
I don't think so.
No. I don't think so.
So I'm gonna right now just be the stat template thing was a mistake that we all asked for.
We did. 100%.
I didn't ask for it. Yeah. To be fair, I didn't. Only PvPers ask for it.
Yeah, we 100%.
See, it takes a PvE-er to know what's best for PvP.
Oh, is that Jay Wilson? I'm kidding.
but the thing is like I'm glad that it happened. I wish that it worked. It doesn't. Good. We're getting rid of it. But I wanted to go back and we talked about how PvP the gear is, and I have a question for Alan. But with PvP, the way that the gear actually changed in PvE, the way that transmog affected the game, and the way that LFR comes in, and all of a sudden it's like, oh yeah, I can just get that tier. It's just going to be a color different. Who gives? Like, I remember how much of a driving force it really was for me to even decide which alt I was going to play because I wanted it to look a certain way.
Because the gear was just so badass.
And now it's just like, oh, I'll just play LFR in my alt. There's nothing pushes you to be better. The only thing that pushes me to be better right now is the people I play with. Now the question I have,
Mage Tower. That was the one thing.
Yeah.
All right. I have a question
for Alan. Okay. So Alan, it's no secret that you and I are both big gamblers, right? If you actually look at how gambling works, and I'm curious to hear how you feel about it. As someone who's, I've gambled my whole life. I grew up in Atlantic City. I'm not proud of it. It's not a good thing. It's not a particularly wholesome pastime. But now I do a show in Vegas every week, so I'm in Vegas every single week. So I gamble because I get bored. When I do play, there is this thing that happens as someone who's gambled for a while that I do not feel anything unless I am pushing it. I'm making a bigger bet than I've ever made before. This is why you don't gamble because you
yes, please don't gamble.
Terrible habit. But when I was a kid, I gambled with $20,
yeah,
holy shit, the world's gonna end if I lose this money. What's gonna happen? Now I can't not play at a high stakes table. My heart won't even beat. I'll have a terrible beat. I'll lose the table max in one hand and be like, ugh, don't feel anything. that is toxic, right? That's not enjoyable. It's this excitement that you're chasing. You're chasing the goddamn dragon. Did you feel a similar way to legendaries as you did at a table at a casino?
I mean, like, I'm going to be completely honest. Like, I think everybody's sentiment that legendaries don't feel as they used to before. Like, I called them glorified purples at the moment. So, I mean, I want to go to back to that Vegas, baby, like, feeling where...
Everybody's like, Rich has a gambling problem. I'm like, yes, please send help. I had to quit, like, my second day in Vegas. I'm done. I'm actually done unless I'm with Alan.
Oh boy.
Because no, it's not skill-based. We want skill-based games.
That's why I play poker, baby. No, but seriously, change the legendaries, please. But yeah, definitely chase that feeling, and let's hope we get sometime and somehow back to the way we used to feel about the legendaries. Cosmetics, dude. Cosmetics are everything. The Asmongold's cosmetic, like transmog shows, are a testament of how popular cosplay. Well, let me
build on
are.
That a little bit more, Hobby, because I think that's a great idea and a great concept, and it's completely true. Whenever sometimes I'll invite people into the group that have like very, very rare or removed items, right? So like the ring from Kel'Thuzad and Max 40, or just something that's just incredibly rare that you've never seen before, like like an old Max 40 weapon, corrupted Ashbringer. Things that you probably don't even know what they are, and these people have them, and I can kind of share that, like old ZG items, and people love that kind of stuff. Like, my views go up, everybody wants to see it, people are excited, and that kind of stuff is really cool. And I feel like Blizzard, they've tried to give everybody that experience, but that experience is fundamentally, it's a fundamentally unique experience, right? If everybody's special, then nobody's special. It's one of those situations.
Yeah, I agree.
It's like,
yeah.
if I saw somebody with Atiesh, right, the old Max 40 staff, everybody would be like, oh my god, that's fucking amazing, right? Or Scaraboard or something like that. The reason that those things are amazing is because that everybody doesn't have them. If everybody had them, nobody would care. Exclusivity and value are pretty much inversely proportional. The more exclusive something is, the more valuable it is.
And I think
the less exclusive it is, the less valuable it is. Like, who here feels good because they have the snowy griffin? Oh, boy. Wow. Hey, guys. Yo, I got the bronze drake yesterday. Oh, boy. Wow. It's just, of course, nobody cares about it because everybody has it. You know, having things that are unique is what makes you feel special.
But dude, when I see someone with a Mimiron's head.
Oof. There's a place for the snowy griffin. There's a place for the bronze drake, and that's kind of what I wanted to get to. Is I think that pretty much all the additions, like with the way the wrist works, world quest, things like that, I think that they are good. I think that they are good for the game, for the longevity of the game. I think they're healthy for the game, but that doesn't mean that the other stuff needs to go away for that stuff to exist. Give us the other stuff that allows players to thrive, have goals, become better players, and have like these real in-game deterministic goals to try to achieve. I like most of the systems in Legion. Most of the systems in Legion, my mother, who just learned how to text a couple of months ago, could probably figure out how to play, and she could probably end up having a good time with it. And I think that that is fine. I think that great.
Sure.
The game attracts a wide amount of people. I think that really is a good thing because that's where a lot of us came from. We weren't attracted to the game for the things that we do now. A lot of us weren't attracted. Sorry, did you start playing World of Warcraft to PvP?
No, I actually was a PvE-er.
No, I did all parts of the game until like BC, then I exclusively PvP'd, but I was a huge noob. I moved with my arrow keys when I first started playing. It was my first MMO.
Dude, I thought auto attack was an actual spell.
Well, one of the things that was especially rewarding and I think addicting to a lot of players is the fact that the hierarchy in WoW is not the same as the hierarchy in real life, right? In real life, you have people that, you know, they have like rich parents, right? So they have advantages. You have people that are taller, and so they have advantages. You have people that are more attractive, and they have advantages. People that are, you know, smarter, and they have more advantages. And people that just know other people, and they have more advantages, etc. And there are all these structural advantages that real life has that can make a lot of people, especially people that are like, you know, teenagers, feel like the world is stacked against them and life is just not really in their favor. And I think one thing that Warcraft really did is that it put everybody on an even playing field, and the people that wanted to put in the most effort and try the hardest. And it wasn't a matter of how rich your parents were, or, you know, how attractive you were, or how strong you were, or anything like that. It's how much could you put effort into something? You know, how could you, just by completely your own effort and time and dedication, achieve something that's yours and your own? And I think that's something that is what really addicted people to the game. And that's something that people don't really talk about a lot, because I think it's kind of an uncomfortable conversation. But I think that it's honestly at the core of a lot of people's mindsets, and something that's definitely true for many of the people that started playing the game, I would say Wrath of the Lich King and before.
That was beautiful.
Damn.
That was beautiful,
it's
man.
True.
Bible thumbs in the chat,
it
please.
Is true, yeah.
Thank you.
I remember the feeling of being like, just, you go onto the game and all of a sudden you're God. Like, it didn't matter who the fuck you were friends with in high school. Nothing mattered. Didn't matter if you grew up in a shitty area. All of a sudden, you got to just feel like a legend. You had goals. You had people there that cared about you. And I remember too, like,
and that's why that's why I advocate for it so much. It's not really because I want to feel good because I have this cool item. Like, the truth is that, I mean, I'm 27 years old now. Like, I don't, the same sense of satisfaction that I get out of getting a cool item in World of Warcraft is much different at 27 than it was at 16, right? But what's more important for me is to make sure that people that, you know, are 16 now, the Asmongolds, you know, 16-year-old Asmongolds of today, they have the same experience that I did. And I feel like preserving that experience is much more important than preserving anything for myself, because I know that I'll never have that experience again, and I don't think any of us will at all. But the idea that knowing that some other kid can come into the game and experience what we experienced and have what we had, that's really special.
But that experience put us all here too. That's the other thing to note about it. And this goes back to what I was asking Zaryu. Like, obviously this experience all put us in a place. It gave us confidence. It allowed us to kind of be these people who can talk about the game. But this is why I asked Zaryu if he started as a PvP player, because nobody really knew what they were starting as with WoW. That's right. Why I do think a lot of these things are good that invite people into the game, but the game didn't force you down a lane. There were all of these ways that you could become a legend. It was PvP, it was PvE, it was all of these different things, and the game needs to leave those pathways open so people can go down them and find that self-worth.
Well,
really.
you found your own way in a fantasy world, right? And in many ways, like, the original game was less of a game and more of a fantasy world simulator. And it's something that kind of gave somebody an option to step into this entirely different world with an entirely different social structure, social system, social norms, social expectations. Everything was completely different, but it was also the same. And I feel like what you wanted to do in the game was completely up to you, right? I remember, like, my mom would just, like, farm out fish and stuff like that, and she got more satisfaction and fulfillment out of that than she does out of Legion, right? Even though everything, you know, like, all the raids and everything like that is open to her. And so I think that giving somebody the pathway and giving them the opportunity to succeed and the privilege to fail is something that the game has forgotten about, and it's disappointing.
That's what drew me to WoW initially. Like, all my friends would say, oh, why don't you play this campaign, or like Halo campaign or Zelda or something. And I'm like, in those games, there's an arrow pointing to where I should be going. Like, in WoW, I can do whatever I want. I can sit in a city and roleplay for the next 8 hours if I want. You know, I can make gold by slash dancing if I want. You know, I can I can play the auction house. I can level. I can PvP. I can do like, I can do nothing. Like, the fact that I could just stand there and do nothing and have fun was beautiful. And, you know, I think that's what drew me to WoW initially, more than PvP or PvE.
We've talked about a few things in WoW that we want to change, and I want to mention a post that you talked about it, Josh, a few days ago or yesterday, which was posted in Mo Champion. It was a post from a Blue. I don't know who exactly tweeted it. Did you know? It was just like it showed up on Mo Champion. Shout out to Mo Champion. Thank you so much. It showed up, and it listed a lot of changes that are happening to BFA PvP, and a lot of the changes that we said on the show are actually coming to the game. Have you seen it, Zach, too?
Yeah, so there's new ranking system, new item level.
Right, yeah. Can you explain that for us?
Yeah, so the new ranking system, it's going to be like a gold, plat, you know, silver, bronze, etc. for your current rating in World of Warcraft. So if you're, you know, 0 rated through 1400 rated, you're going to have like a bronze little emblem, or I mean, it might just be unranked, and then for, it's arbitrary, the numbers, but, you know, 1400 through 1600 is going to be silver, you know, 1800 through 2K is going to be, it's going to be gold, whatever. So in the seasons, there's going to be a like a little icon or a rank that you're going to be ranked by, which I think is great. This is something that we've talked to Blizzard about, like, a lot in the past, and it's, I think it's going to be where, like, the old prestige emblem was, like, right next to your frame. So if you're walking around and you see someone with the highest, or gladiator, or whatever they want to call it, rank, I think that's pretty cool. So that's, like, the first new thing that we saw in the blue post.
That's amazing. That's something we've been talking about on the show, and the fact that you can see your rank in-game, like, instead of, like, going, like, obviously, if you're a high-rated and high-tiered PvP player, you will know the steps of, like, checking your rank and calculating it and so on. But for a newcomer that actually sees his rank progress to challenger, rival, to us, that's an indescribable feeling. It's what drives you to become a better PvPer. So big shout-out to Blizzard for adding that into the system. It's amazing.
Also, they're independent of the player base, right? Well, it's like right now, Gladiator, for example, is the top 0.5%. Some seasons, Gladiator is 2,500, and some seasons, it's 2,700. The system now that we have, or that they're adding in BFA, is going to make Gladiator every single time, like, 2,375 or something like that, or 2,350. I forgot really what it was. But I don't know if that's going to correlate to in-season rewards, and I don't know how that's going to work either. I think that they're going to be separate, and they're going to be given separately, but it's certainly an interesting way of doing it. I don't know if it's going to be worse or better yet, though.
From what I've seen, the end-of-season rewards are still using more of the old design, where it's percentage-based, and it's not a concrete number. That'll
be a good idea.
Yeah, but which could be confusing as well if they're still doing a... You know, in-game, I'm Gladiator, I'm the highest rank, but at the end of the season, I didn't make the top percentage for Gladiator. That's a bit confusing as well. So I still think they're fleshing all of that out. Yeah.
It's a little change that really does go a long way. And 100%. I would also really like to see, kind of in line with what we're talking about, I would love to see the gear just be super friggin' exclusive. Like, I would love to actually see gear in-game kind of also build players up the same way, but it's nice to have any system do it. I love the fact that they're having these simple little icons. Even if you don't PvP, it's going to be pretty clear if somebody is a god or not when you do see them in town. That's a great step. So very excited about that. Let's talk about honor talents, though, a little bit while we're talking about PvP.
Honor talents are bad.
I definitely think you know, it's crazy because I feel like we've had...
I don't think classes should function differently in PvP and PvE.
I agree with that. Yeah.
There are some abilities that have to function differently, right? I mean, I'm thinking like Draft of Souls, for example. But for the most part, I think the idea of having different abilities, and especially like whenever it's an entirely new ability that only works in PvP, I think that's very bad for the game.
So, we haven't even talked about just getting rid of honor talents in a while. Usually, we're kind of talking about the honor talents themselves because the system has just, it feels like it's been around for a while. But the thing is like, Zarya, when we looked at the honor talents this time around, there really aren't that many new abilities being added. That was the big thing. Yeah, that was the big thing that Chuck was saying. So, how do you feel about honor talents in their current iteration?
So, I mean, I've played Mage, Rogue, Priest, and Warlock, I think, so far on the beta, and I haven't really seen any new talents at all. So basically, if you guys watching, like, don't know, there's about 10, 11, 12 honor talents to choose from. You get three slots. You get to choose any three. So the one upside is that it actually is interesting to see what kind of combinations you can make from those 10, 11, 12 talents, because they're combinations that you've never seen before. The downside is you only get to pick three compared to previously we had, I think, six, right? In addition,
some are passive, though, but yeah.
Yeah. So in addition, you get the Gladiator's Medallion slot. So on top of that, you get to choose Adaptation, Relentless, or Trinket. I mean, so that makes things a little bit interesting as well. But yeah, a lot of people are saying there need to be more PvP talents. I kind of agree with Zach that PvP and PvE, like, your class shouldn't fundamentally be designed differently if you're fighting somebody, if you're fighting a dragon, you know? Like, it's completely different rotations based on something like Deep Shatter or Concentrated Coolness.
I think one of the big mistakes that Blizzard's made throughout the years is kind of segregating the player base and making it to where people are PvPers or PvEers, people are raiders or, you know, like Mythic Plus players, etc. I think the entire game should function as an ecosystem rather than it just being independent ecosystems that you can move back and forth between.
So what were the good things about, like, let's just break this down.
The good
down
things really about far. Honor Talents.
It allows for separate tuning knobs, right? That's the main upside. Yep. Is there any other upside besides
well,
that?
Well, yeah. I mean, obviously, there's a lot of really good things about them. Like, if you look at the abilities themselves, I think the abilities themselves were really cool. Like, Sharpen Blade, I think, is absolutely a really, really cool ability for warriors. Having Execute make you charge to your target if you're close enough is really cool. There are a lot of really interesting honor talents that they've added into the game, and I love them. Like, in a perfect world, and I know a lot of people are going to hate me for saying this, I feel like honor talents should be unlockable, like, universally, but you should have to do PvP to get them. And I know, like, that would kind of force people into PvP, and I'm like, yeah, that's right. You know, because that's part of the game. And if you want to fully unlock your character, you should have to play your character fully in every bit of content. I don't think that's what's going to happen, but in a perfect world, that's what I would prefer.
Yeah, there's no way, like, a change that drastic can happen within, like, 2 months. Yeah, I mean, so PvP, all in talents are for sure staying. Is there any way we can improve them? That's the question.
Yeah, and I agree with that sentiment, though, Alan. It's one of those things where if we think about the extremes, we actually get to the core of it, right? Like, what's interesting about the thing that Zach just said right now, if you have this thing where people have to do PvP, we've obviously seen that goes both poorly and it has upside. But one of the other things that's interesting is it's like one of those things where you see a new player and doesn't have those honor talents, and then you kind of know, oh, you can teach them. Does that work, though, in the current iteration of the game? Not really as much because of how sharding works. So there are all these different things that you can say, okay, step by step, this is why this works, this is why this doesn't work. But what you're saying about what can we do to make honor talents better, definitely a thing to think about. Zaryu, is there anything in particular that you would like to see changed with this new system that we're going to see in BFA?
I mean, it's kind of hard. It's really hard to say. Like, I want more than probably 10 or 11 choices. Maybe a couple more choices would be good. And then a lot of people are saying there needs to be, like, six honor talent, you know, six choices instead of three, kind of how we've had. That would be a lot.
Yeah,
then you could pick effectively half of your choices, and you could put, like, a bunch of OP combos. So I don't know if that's really the solution. I don't know if I have a great solution for how honor talent should work.
Just a bad idea.
Yeah, I mean, I really don't know.
Yeah, maybe add one more extra choice on each row. Like, I'm not sure, like, new abilities, but at the same time,
I think where they're at right now is probably as good as it's going to get. I mean, I'm sure there are other ways that they could change it that might be more preferable to some people in the player base, but other people would dislike it. So it's one of those situations where, you know, if you change it and you make some people happy, you're going to make those other people unhappy, and they might as well just stick with what they have.
Klepto Temp's going to be really cool.
Yeah,
just a little side thought. Yeah, like there are cool things that can happen with this new one.
Yeah,
definitely. But having only three choices, like, do you feel like a lot of specs will feel like they're in a place where there are certain things that they have to take regardless of situation every time?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I've played my rogue, and it seems like two of the three are, like, pretty much baseline because they're just really, really, really good. But I think that's kind of how we've always seen it, and I think that's just how metagames evolve. Like, I think, like, one big mistake is people get upset when there's one, like, correct way to play. I mean, I think that's pretty much how it is in any game ever throughout the history of the universe. Like, there's always one way to do things once people really, really, really hone things down. Even back in Vanilla WoW, there was a best build. Same with BC, there was a best build. There are some slight things you could change, but there's slight things you can change now, but depending on what you're fighting. So I don't know if it's really right to get upset that we have to.
I think in regard, that's a very good point. I think in terms of, like, you know, like, yeah, you're going to have all these amazing options, and you're going to go to Icy Veins, and you're just going to click the best three that they tell you to click, and you're never going to think about it again. You know, yeah, that's what most people are going to do. That being said, I do think Legion has done a better job than almost all the other expansions in regard to giving people more choice in terms of how they want to play in PvP. In terms of, like, the different abilities and, like, honor talents and talents, etc. You know, you change a lot of your gameplay based off of what you're fighting now.
You know, one thing that I liked about changing in PvP that we kind of saw go away in with stat templates was changing how your character interacted with stats, right? Like, I want to go a little bit more haste, or I want to go a little bit more crit. And that was just kind of, like, yeah, that was a little bit, like, different than picking talents, because there kind of still was like a cookie cutter build, but you could stray from that just a little bit, which I kind of like to see, you know. So customizing like haste, specifically haste, seems really good, because like, do you want slower globals and be more powerful, or do you want quicker globals and have things not hit as much, but maybe land a little bit more CC so you're getting more effective damage out? Things like that, like, really changed the game for me.
It's also, it's like, when you put that in conjunction with talents, then there isn't as much of a cookie cutter thing. There are things that appear to be right for given situations, but you need to know how to play that as well, right? Yeah. So it's like, if you've never played a haste build before, and then all of a sudden you're going to be playing this crazy haste build with new talents, yeah, you may not be able to do it. So I actually really do think, the more I'm thinking about it now, honor talents in conjunction with actually being able to change stat templates opens up more avenues than we've even thought about before, right? All of a sudden, I'm stacking mastery, and maybe this one talent that I've never used before does become powerful, and that might be good into X healer, for example. So that is something that I think is a potential upside of this new system that we're seeing.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of things like that that, I mean, there are going to be positives with everything, right? I mean, I'm not saying that there are no positives with honor talents, right? I mean, obviously, they do make it does make PvP in a way more interesting, that like you have like these special abilities that you can only use in PvP, but it's just everything has an upside and a downside.
So, I really, the thing that I want to say is, like, we're picking at these upsides and downsides. I think that the really big problem here that's just kind of annoying and going into an expansion does not feel good, and I think it's justified that people are really pissed off about it. There are, like, no new abilities coming for anyone. Like, how is that, like, first of all, you have honor talents now in one lane. You have your other talents in other lanes. You can add new busted abilities. This is the whole reason that we have this protection here. I didn't want to jump right in, and I wanted to stop yelling for a second, but how the fuck does that make sense? The whole reason that we put the honor talents here and we put the other abilities over here is so you can have those separate tuning knobs, so you can actually adjust that stuff. Why are we not getting a new ability in a new MMO expansion? That doesn't make sense to me.
I completely agree. And even if we get new abilities on our necklace or gear, it still seems like PvP talents, if they're going to keep them the way they are, there should definitely at least be a
fucking necklace. Like, why the fuck does that sound good to anyone? I don't care about this fucking necklace. I'm so sick of this goddamn fucking necklace. Sure, maybe it works. Maybe it works. But I don't know.
I was just trying to give them the benefit of the doubt. But yeah.
I agree. Okay. I don't think anybody really gives a shit about it. I mean, the thing about it is that, like, with your artifact weapon, you go through this big quest line, and with this, it's like, hey, Magni just came in through an invisible wall, and he's like, hey, kid, you want a necklace? And then he takes you down to his basement, and he gives you a necklace.
Oh, my God.
That's what happens.
It is 100% what happens. I told the example on last week's episode, because I was doing it on stream after two weeks ago, maybe. I did it on stream with Annie, and we didn't even realize we had it. Because, like, the whole thing was, like, we were trying to get this necklace, and, yeah, we didn't read our quests as well as we should have. But, you know, we were having fun just going about doing our quests. And we were, like, trying to figure out, like, who was going to get on. We were going to try to do a dungeon because Zach was maybe going to come back. Alan, you were figuring out stuff, and was like, oh, cool, we're all going to get to do a dungeon together. And it was like, yeah, we need to make sure we get the Heart of Azeroth if we're going to do the dungeon. It was like, did you get the Heart of Azeroth? It's like, I think I did. And sure, that's something that can change how epic getting the Heart of Azeroth is. But that's, like, a leveling thing. And the leveling feels good in BFA. The zones are better than ever before. The dungeons look better than ever before. I'm incredibly excited for Mythic Plus. I think Mythic Plus is going to be absolutely insane. But this no tier thing, in conjunction with this with the neck and not getting any new abilities.
This is what I was talking about before with the segregation, where the reason that they're removing tier sets, one of the other reasons, is because it makes it to where, like, Mythic Plus players have to do raids, right? And I think, obviously, with PvE, Blizzard might not say this, but I think it's true that if it's not true, it's going to be true, that Blizzard is going to gear PvE more towards Mythic Plus than raiding. And with that being the case...
I mean, that's what it feels like.
Yeah. And with the MDI, obviously, they have, like, more to gain with that. So whenever that happens... obviously they're going to design the game around Mythic Plus, and it's just another example of them, you know, basically creating micro communities that are completely self-sufficient and not giving people reasons to play other elements of the game.
I kind of like the fact that even when casting the Mythic Dungeon Invitational in the past weeks,
yeah,
knowing what guild these people come from, knowing who they had to play with to make sure they had their tier gear, knowing if they continue to raid at the top level, knowing if, like, Trill is one of the most interesting people to talk about in World of Warcraft esports. Why? Because he fucking PvPs and PvEs. That is insane. That is insane. It is an enigma, and it's something to really be respected. That isn't something that the game really does push you to do. There isn't a reward for being all together just the best at something, being the best at a class in every single capacity. Multiclassing, I feel like, is rewarded, but multiclassing is something that does divide attention in a certain way that you can't truly multiclass in every single faculty of the game, right? I really do think that it should be somewhat more all-inclusive, but the experience, this is obviously a dream thing to say, right? I think it should be a way that you get this overall crazy reward, the same way that you look at getting above 75 traits, right? It's, yeah, there's a little bit of an advantage, but at the end of the day, you're just min-maxing, right? You're going to be able to, if you are a good monk and you have 75 traits, you're going to be able to do similar damage to a monk with 76 traits. You can probably even out-DPS them. So I want it to feel like that if you do every single aspect of the game, but isolated, if you're a Mythic Plus player, if you're a raider, if you're a PvPer, they have a reward system that is all-encompassed within that system. For the most part, I think they can go a little bit further than that. Like, yes, I don't mind that you have to get your tier gear, and then you can get your gear from Mythic Plus.
Food for thought. Do you guys think that the MDI has so much attention because there's just no other representation of covering like a raid race or raid streams or raid competitions? Do you guys think? I know that the complexity and the logistics of doing raid races is absolutely incredibly hard, but is there a way to still drag the raid races and make them seem sort of like relevant?
I think the viewing experience of a raid race with 40 people, 20 people, whatever it is, versus just five is just worse. Just having five people being able to talk about each talent, each skill, what they're doing, just seems a lot easier to follow from a PvPer's point of view from the outside.
Yeah.
Well, you just have to scale up the way that you cast it and help people understand it too. You know, the group is doing this boss rather than this player is casting this spell. And obviously, like, with the more people that you're playing with and the more people that are involved, the less intricate you can go into, like, defining what each player is doing in whatever activity that they're doing. But, I mean, with that being said, obviously, like, yeah, I think that raid races could be successful. But logistically, I don't really think they're ever going to work. And I think they'd be much more suited as being kind of a fan event rather than a Blizzard event.
Like a showcase.
I mean, like, they could do something at BlizzCon, right? Something at BlizzCon could be interesting, but I just don't really think Blizzard wants to invest the money into it.
I don't think Blizzard gives a hoot nanny about how much money they invest at BlizzCon. I feel like BlizzCon is kind of that time of year where they're just going to spend.
Well, how much? If they don't care, then how much is the tournament? How much is winning BlizzCon, the 3v3 tournament?
I don't even know what the prize pool is. I actually should know.
I should know that too.
Yeah,
I think it wasn't 115k,
which goes to show that, like, it's probably not that. But I don't even think they announced a BlizzCon.
They haven't this, but last year's was 125 for the winning team. No, something like that.
Yeah, but also, like, this year, the prize pool for online tournaments increased already by 300%.
Yeah, hopefully.
So it'll probably be larger,
So, like, prize pool's already been jumping up a whole bunch. Prize pool's obviously a thing that...
It's 250K. I don't know about this year, but it'd probably be actually like 300K. Because it said 2016, 2015 were both 250,000, and 2017 was 280,000. So you take 280,000, let's say it's 300,000, cut that in half, right? Because it's going to be four people, and then assume the org doesn't take a cut. Then you take the taxes from the prize winning, so you've got 75,000 for each person, right? Because that's 300,000 divided by four. Cut that basically in half with prize winnings.
No, but like that's like for all the teams.
That's all the teams. That's not just the winning team. Your math's actually wrong. It's and your math is that's too kind. Yeah. So I mean, oh, hey, look, I totally yeah. No, I totally agree there. And that's kind of the thing with like Call of Duty, for example. Like we probably do a tournament every month or something like that, and every month those tournaments are worth like 100.
So that's the entire prize pool. That's not even. Yeah, I thought you got that just for first place.
No.
Okay, so I was doing. All right.
Probably.
So
that's why I thought you divided. That's why I thought you divided in half, because I'm pretty sure first place tends to get.
Okay.
Half.
Well, let's say it gets half. You know, let's say you get half. So that's like what is that? That's what is that? Let's say it's 150,000. Divide that by three. Let's say for at least three players. It's easy to do. 50,000. Cut that in half, or let's say just, you know, take 10% away from that, 10% away from that for just like the org, right? If they have an org sponsoring them.
Yeah.
So that's going to be 45,000. Then you take that, cut that in half for prize winnings and also taxes. You're looking at coming away with less than 30 grand for winning BlizzCon per person. And that's assuming that you split it three ways. You don't have a fourth player.
That's I mean,
it's fucking garbage.
It's terrible. I don't disagree, but I think that they're
like you can work at McDonald's or you can win BlizzCon. Hey, you come away with the same amount of money.
This is gonna sound weird though. This is gonna sound weird because I'm not disagreeing with you at all. But I think that those are two very different things to accompany mentally. Like I think Blizzard will be more likely to do a different show, like do an additional show, do a raid race. This is just my personal opinion. I think that they would be more likely to do that than increase prize pool, right? Prize pool is something that's existed for such a long amount of time.
Dude,
it's almost like, but no. But the thing is just like, think about how the MDI came into existence. Prize pools,
the heroes tournament was $1 million.
They're completely different branches. I agree. This shit pisses me. That's stupid.
I mean, yeah, they are different branches, and Warcraft is a tree, and Heroes is a shrub, so it should be the opposite.
Hey man, the thing is, there's this moment where you kind of have to throw your hands up in the air and say I think if there is
a counter argument, it's that it's a PvP tournament, and the large majority of the player base doesn't even PvP, right? So if the entire game was WoW PvP and there was, you know, 4 or 5 million subscribers and the biggest tournament of the entire year was, you know, you come home with 30,000, I think that would be a bigger issue. I mean, I agree with you too. I'm a PvPer. I would love a $1 million prize pool, but PvP represents maybe 10% of the game. Maybe.
Hey, look, Zaryu and I probably won it the most, having had to be in the place where you actually say how much the prize money is, and maybe it even dictates how many people are watching you do your job, right? I think that it's obvious that a prize pool increases something that I want to have, but when you actually, the reason that I don't like to talk about it that much is because there are company things going on that I don't understand. And I've just come to accept that to a certain degree. You can be vocal and say that you want it, but why does HOTS get that prize pool? Why does WoW get its prize pool? At the end of the day, we're not going to be able to figure it out
unless people talk about it and call it out, then nothing's going to change.
Didn't
right?
we call
I
mean, it like, out last year, though?
I'll keep doing it.
Yeah.
I agree with that, but what I'm saying is, trying to actually logically figure out why is a waste of time. I think the thing is more what our job should be to do and what we should kind of strive to do is explain why the prize pool should be at a certain place without comparing it to anything else. Just letting the value of the PvP community talk for itself. You know what I'm saying? Because there's obviously not a comparison going on there the way that we're trying to make the comparison. So that rhetoric probably won't work to someone who's watching this. And so it's almost one of the things where you look and you say, these players are providing this much entertainment. There are 6 weeks of PvP tournaments in every single season. There are three seasons, right? It's three seasons. Then there's going to be two LANs, and then there's going to be BlizzCon. That's a huge amount of time investment from these teams. They should be rewarded in a certain way. I honestly think that they should have salaries. I've said that many times before. They're providing 18 weeks of entertainment besides the LANs. That is your job. That is your full-time job. That is your life. That's my life right now. I haven't had a single weekend where I've just gotten to go out with friends and grab a drink and be a human being because of the amount of hate that's going on.
What is that? Look at me, I'm pale as a paper.
I love it. Like, I love it. I genuinely love it. And I put myself in situations where I probably work more than I should. That's on me. But at the end of the day, these players are doing the same thing. It's their full-time job. They should be compensated, regardless of if a game – there's another game that gets 5 billion viewers and they get paid $5, or if there's a game over on this other side that gets zero – or gets 1,000 million viewers, they get $5, or if they get no viewers and they're getting paid.
Well, I think it does put it in perspective, right? I agree with what you're saying, and it should be independent. But at the same time, I think that looking at it as a whole – does include looking at the prize pools from other games, especially other games that are part of the same company. I understand what you're saying. I do. I just think they need to do a much better job in terms of compensating players and making PvP meaningful. But the big problem right now is that PvP tournaments have been doing actually like kind of well recently, more really so well than last year. Yeah. But obviously like they don't have the same viewership as they used to like back in like Cataclysm days or Wrath of the Lich King days. And why is that? I think one of the reasons for that is because the player base isn't there. And I think PvP is like, if you want to look at PvP, you want to look at it as like a pyramid, right? And making the top of the pyramid work is great. But the most important thing is making sure that base is steady and it will hold up the entire rest of the, pyramid itself. And I feel like PvP right now, especially for a casual player, is very lackluster. Very shallow, very hollow, very meaningless, and that needs to change.
I was just going to kind of agree with what Asmongold was saying. Instead of like looking at the prize pool and being like, oh, we should change the prize pool from 250,000 to 500,000, I think we have to look at why the tournaments, at least for PvP, aren't getting, you know, 50 or 60,000 viewers, or, you know, why aren't they bigger than they are? And it's just because, to me at least, it's because a lot of the PvP community has quit throughout the years. And why are they quitting?
PvP is hard to watch.
You think so? Yeah, I guess I'm pretty
how can
biased.
You tell, how can you tell that an interrupt goes out?
Yeah, I think the UI could have improvements as well.
Yeah,
I think the nature of
PvP is difficult too. What I was saying is just a lot of people have been quitting because more and more abilities have been removed. If you go and interview all the past rank one players or gladiator players that quit, they're all going to say the same thing. Like, just no abilities in the game anymore. The game isn't as fun as, you know, previous expansions. We don't get to one shot anymore. It's all my abilities do no damage, stuff like that, just over and over and over. It's you hear the same things.
I mean, like, there's the iconic, and down goes Vanruki, and that happened because of a snap of a second. I'm not saying fighting DM was the best, but
I think there's a big distinction that needs to be made from, like, Burning Crusade and Wrath, which is, like, the prime of WoW PvP versus expansions like today. So right now, in Legion, people may disagree with me, but it's probably one of the most balanced times we've ever seen. If we look at class representation, every single healer has been played at a tournament level. Almost every single DPS class, including tanks, have been played at a tournament level. We have rogues, mage, hunters, ferals, druids, shamans. There's nothing that hasn't been played at a tournament level. That's incredible in terms of balance. And I think what we have to really understand is that having fun in the game is a lot different than the game being balanced. Because in BC and Wrath, the game was not balanced at all. People were one-shotting left and right. There was only 50% of the classes actually played in tournaments, and the game was not balanced whatsoever, but the game was fun.
How do you feel about right now? Because it kind of seems like we're in a place where we're going to be going through this next season. We haven't really seen changes, right? So this is going to be a very similar tournament split than we saw to the last one, which isn't something that happens very often in WoW. Like, I expect to actually see those jungles continue to be strong. We expect to see monks continue to stay strong. And then all of a sudden, just with how the timeline looks, that's pretty much going to be the last look that we have at this expansion until BFA comes out. Do you think that that's healthy for the game? Because I do agree, relatively balanced right now, but do you think it's healthy for it to stay in this kind of same lane that it's in right now?
I don't know. I think people would give you like varying answers on that one. There's some games that have been on the same patch for years and years, and people continue to love them. But inevitably, you have to change, or else the game's going to die out. If you keep the same patch for 10 years, you know, people are going to get bored and stop playing. So I understand that you can't just keep one patch forever, or else people will just stop playing.
We have to develop and evolve the meta in a way that's rewarding and it makes the game better, or it just makes it different, right? Just make sure that it doesn't get worse. I think that anybody can probably think of like their favorite patch, right? Which probably coincides whenever their class was overpowered. Sure, yeah. And I think that Warcraft always had like situations where each class kind of gets their time in the sun, and that's cool in a way, but at the same time, you don't want to spend the entire expansion waiting for your 6 months of fame, right? And I think that like Legion overall did do a pretty good job with class balance, I would say. I mean, there were obviously some more ridiculous examples like having tanks and PvP, etc., that I don't think was very good, but I do think that the reason that Arena isn't really as watchable as something like the Mythic Plus MDI is, yeah, like one thing that you said, Zara, you obviously less people participate in Arena than they do Mythic Plus. I think that's pretty much a fact, or at least dungeons in general. And on top of that, I think there are just so many abilities and so many things that are going on in Arena that players don't really have the ability to accurately understand and appreciate what's going on. And I think a good example of this is whenever everybody gets up and starts cheering and beating those little, you know, inflatable things together, you know, at the BlizzCon stage, remember, they're gonna kill a rep paladin who has the auto bubble talent, right? They're like, oh my god, he's gonna die. Well, no, he's not gonna die. And dude, they don't know what the hell is going on, and it's completely obvious the audience doesn't really understand it. And because the audience doesn't understand it, they don't appreciate it as much, and they can't enjoy it as much. I would like to see more elements and more types of PvP be put into the game on a competitive level. I think RPGs would be amazing. I would love that. I've said that a million times.
I've been saying that for years.
You feel the same way?
Yeah, definitely. So okay. One point that I like to make a lot is that it's really difficult to balance games in a strictly a team deathmatch format. Right. If you look at competitive games, League of Legends, it's not team deathmatch. You know, we look at Counter-Strike, there's a bomb you have to plant. We look at any popular competitive game, it's always objective based. We don't see team deathmatch games really get too popular for the most part. There are some. But in World of Warcraft, for some reason, TDM, 3v3 has been what's really been pushed instead of the objective based style, capturing the flag or defending a node. And I think it's much easier to balance when you have a class, say, like, maybe like mage, maybe it doesn't do the most damage, but look, I can polymorph a ninja and node, so I can provide value in another way, or I can give you guys a buff in a group setting. So it's easier to balance, it's easier to watch, the objectives are more clear. Yeah,
like it's I think it's cool watching people run in with Shroud of Concealment.
I think 6v6 RBGs, I think even 10v10 with some modifications, I think a lot of those things are really, really cool for PvP.
Something to ask you real quick, Josh. Sure. Arguably, BC was the most popular time for WoW Arena. WoW was at MLG, it was popping. I remember being inspired to play PvP and pursue PvP more actively because of those matches, because of the legendary RMP versus RMP mirrors that were absolutely insane.
Yeah.
Do you think we're close to establishing that meta that you can create between RMP versus RMP? Do you think there's a long way to go? What can we do to get there to that exciting point again in the game? Like, make WoW have those, like, heart-wrenching moments that you're like, oh my god, 1%, like, what do you think?
I don't know. It seems like nowadays, with the way the meta has progressed and the way the script has progressed, it's almost like both teams kind of know what they have to do. Both teams do their go. It seems like a lot of the game is a lot more on script, whereas in the past, it was more just like, team is going to do a play, and then a counterplay is going to happen, and then based on that counterplay, another team is going to do a play. It's completely off script and completely just on the fly. PvP nowadays feels like a script that you're just following.
Well, the script is called cooldowns, and whenever cooldowns are so powerful that define your character, then obviously you're just sitting there waiting for cooldowns, and you trade cooldowns with defensives, and that's basically it.
Here's the thing. Here's the thing that I've said a lot, and it's that cooldowns are way too powerful, and not having cooldowns are way too weak, and not by like any small extent. So here's the example. I cast Frostbolt on a vanilla server, a BC server. It does like 10% of someone's life, 20%, maybe 30% if it crits. I cast a Frostbolt on live Legion servers, does 1% of someone's health. That's just... If they doubled Frostbolt's damage right now, it would still be too weak. If they tripled it, 300% increase would be way too weak. If they did a 400% increase, it would be way too weak. That's ridiculous, right? Like, it needs a 10,000%, 15,000%
increase. It's terrible. See, here, that's the problem. Is like, I've used this example with Fury Warriors, right? Fury Warriors have a cooldown that makes every single one of their abilities crit. It gives them a full rage bar. And on top of that, they do 25% more base damage. That's fucking ridiculous. And it happens all the time. Like, you can't just have a cooldown like that and have damage that's outside of that cooldown also be substantial. that cooldown has to define your character, and if it doesn't, the character is just going to be completely overpowered.
Agreed.
And they need to that's the problem. They don't need to fix the GCDs. They need to fix the cooldowns. The cooldowns are just too strong. Icy Veins is strong. You know, I don't think it's like absolutely ridiculous. It's not as powerful as Battlecry. But there are some cooldowns that are just ridiculously good.
Icy Veins right now gives you 30% haste and 20% damage. Just damage. Like that's crazy to me. That's like making your character, you know, 50%
stronger. And it lasts for like a long time too, right?
It lasts
like
20 seconds. If there's a cooldown that's too powerful, and you want to keep the general idea, I think just a very easy way to do it is make Icy Veins 90 seconds instead of 3 minutes, and then make it, you know, 15% haste instead of 30, and instead of 20% damage increase, give it a 5. And then so you essentially nerf Icy Veins, but then you buff Frostbolt, you buff Ice Lance, you know, buff
the base abilities.
Water Elemental, you know, buff damage that are doing, you know, buff things that are doing damage, and you nerf things like Ebon Bolt. You don't make Ebon Bolt kill someone one hit. You nerf things like Frozen Orb. You nerf things like Icy Veins. I'm just talking Mage because I play Mage, but, you know, you nerf the cooldowns, you buff the abilities that actually do damage. Then now you have fast-paced PvP where going back to Hottest's question, now you have something that goes back and forth where, you know, a team can randomly just create counter pressure from just pressing their buttons if their healer was in a slight CC chain. Like, I think that's what makes WoW PvP fun. And yeah, just having this cooldown based system where, oh, he traded Icy Veins, I'm trading Trinket. He traded Bubble, I'm trading Block. He traded this, I'm trading that. It's just,
I would love for Blizzard to start testing in BFA weekly tests where PvPers get to queue up, they test changes of abilities just related to PvP and how it feels. And just have it ready for BFA. BFA is 3 months away. 2 months is a pre-patch. Like the time goal or whatever. It's so close, and hasn't been much testing at all.
Also, this is something that I don't think I've ever really talked about before, but I've talked about it in another element, is that whenever cooldowns are so game-defining, it creates a bigger difference between the skill levels and the output of a very good player and a very bad player. Yep. Zaryu, your example of Frostbolt, any dummy is going to be able to cast Frostbolt, right? But the difference of using Frostbolt now and like using it in conjunction with your cooldowns, etc., that's really what makes your damage really good. And making cooldowns so powerful makes it to where players that don't fully understand how to use their cooldowns are subsequently like a lot weaker than they would be if cooldowns weren't as strong, right? Because not only do they not know how to play their character very well, but they also don't know how to make their cooldowns work in the way that they should. So it's kind of like a multiplicative thing where they're even worse than they would be if, you know, cooldowns weren't as strong.
What I kind of like, and we see cooldowns, and I think I mentioned this a little bit earlier, instead of just having, like right now I'm looking at my mage, like my primary thing that buffs my damage is Icy Veins, like that's it. Whereas in the past you've seen things like Trinket, Icy Veins, proc Trinket, and Banner's Ward, Pet Nova, stuff like that, all kind of work in conjunction to make your damage more powerful. And I think that's kind of what we want to see, is that you can preemptively think, okay, I got this, I got this, I got this. Now I'm piecing my entire build together to now do a large amount of damage. But in the meantime, I can still do some damage instead of just having no damage and then popping Icy Veins and then doing a ton of damage. Like there's a lot of things at play here.
Dude, you remember the days of getting Power Infusion from the priest? I thought that was so sick. When I was playing my priest and I'm like, dude, you have Power Infusion, go, go, go. And like you just try to just build more momentum and more kill opportunities. That was just
wings from a pally. Still wings from a pally. It was really fun.
I will say though, and I've said this before, don't need everything to feel that way, right? Like certain classes can feel really rotty and their damage can just be consistent.
Like Affliction Warlocks.
Affliction Warlocks don't have any cooldowns. Like, and really, unless you go into like whatever that Dark Soul thing is, you don't really have a cooldown besides your artifact ability that, you know, if you're in a battleground, you're trying to keep up all the time. And I like that a lot. That's really cool. And Affliction Warlocks have, like, you know, their damage window of, like, stacking UAs and then also their build-up window. And I like that a lot. Like, Fury Warriors have the idea of, like, you know, they can have Death Wish and, you know, they can deal damage to themselves and become more powerful. And then they just, like, do all of their damage in, like, 5 seconds and try to one-shot somebody. That's really cool. But I do agree with you, Rich, and this is something you've talked about a lot, is the fact that so many of the classes now and specs are built around, weak damage and then big cooldown, big damage, you know. And it's the same paradigm for everything. And it's the same with Death Knights. It's the same with Warriors. It's the same. I mean, Rogues are a little bit different, but it's the same with Mages, right? I mean, everything, same with Warlocks, if you're running Dark Soul, etc. You know, everything is basically the exact same. And I think, really, those cooldowns would be less defining if they weren't as powerful, or if damage outside of those cooldowns was more powerful.
Yeah, I totally agree. And guys, right now, we're going to keep talking for a few minutes here, but we're going to be jumping into questions in just a few short seconds. So if you guys want to start sending us questions to our Twitters, you can do it to the AllCraft Twitter as well, at AllCraft Show, or using the hashtag AllCraft, Instagram, whatever. I don't care. Just get them to us, and then when we actually start the question section, we'll take a peek at chat. We'll make sure that we try not to miss anything. But we really do want to kind of do a deep dive on the questions. But I want to go and kind of close out here before we go into the questions and just talk about class design one more time in BFA, because we have kind of been talking around it quite a bit. We talked about the fact that a lot of stuff felt clunky, the fact that we don't have any new spells or abilities coming in. I want to kind of just really deep dive on that topic before we start taking the questions, because I do think it is a really crazy thing to be entering an expansion and not be getting a single new ability, maybe get back an ability that you used to have a couple years ago. But at the end of the day, like, nothing really new is coming your way. We had artifacts last time that gave us new abilities, things like that. Zaryu, how do you feel about it for even PvP? Like, how do you feel like tournaments are actually going to play out now with all the abilities being pretty much the same?
I think with the same abilities, we're going to see like a similar meta, or at least people pick it up really fast. Whereas like in the past in Legion, like Legion Season 1, people had no idea what was good. People had to test things. I remember the first couple tournaments, people were playing compositions that like shouldn't have even worked, but since no one knew how to play against them, they did fine. Like, that is fun. That is fun to kind of discover new abilities, discover new combinations. And I guess we're going to kind of miss out on that with the new expansion if they don't add a bunch of new abilities and stuff like that. So yeah,
that's actually kind of something that I wanted to say as well. Do you remember how crazy Legion really was? The way that all the compositions worked out. Do you remember it was Chuck, right? When they pulled out Enhancement Shaman, Assassination Rogue. Was it Chuck who threw it out, picked it up, or was it actually Splice who did it? Regardless, we were joking around.
It was delicious. Wacky compositions, because people just didn't know really what to play or how to play it, so people just made compositions out of thin air based on what they thought was good, which is cool. I like to see the meta, you know, kind of evolve like that.
Yeah, so that's crazy that maybe we won't even have that. Let's talk about the PvE side of things, though. Zach, how do you think this is actually going to fare for PvE players leveling and not getting any new abilities?
It's gonna suck.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, like, what else is there to say? It's like whenever I was getting to like level 85, I was like, oh man, I'm gonna be able to get Heroic Leap, and then at level, I'd also get Colossus Smash, and you know, at level 80, I was gonna be able to get Titan's Grip. And actually, I think I could get that before. It was a talent. But, you know, there are all these abilities that you're looking forward to, like getting Heroic Throw, Warriors finally having a ranged ability, etc. You know, whenever you were playing the new expansion or, like, looking forward to it, you were really like, oh my god, you know, like Commanding Shout at level, I think, 68 for Warriors. This was something, you know, Spell Reflection. Like, having Spell Reflection in Burning Crusade was the biggest fucking thing. This is what everybody wanted to have. And they finally added it in, and it was like, oh my god, this is exactly what we wanted. It's great. Where is that now? What am I really looking forward? Like, why do I want to get to level 120? And I don't really know. I mean, like,
yeah. Well, let's look back at how Legion actually fell, right? Because it's been a while since actually like leveled in Legion. So in Legion, you basically. At what? You pretty much instantly got your artifact?
Well, you got your artifact weapon pretty much as soon as you started Legion, and then you just leveled up with those abilities, and then traits kind of modified your gameplay. Or, in some, you know, specific circumstances, they gave you another ability like Syndragosa, right? But for the most part, all of your abilities were given to you before you started leveling. But at least you got one thing, and you got your weapon, right? Which kind of, like, was, in a way, the same thing as getting the as getting new spells, because you had this new weapon, you were getting new traits on your weapon.
Okay, so we got that last time. This time we're going to get to Nyx. Do you think that the Heart of Azeroth will be able to provide, starting with you, Zarya, do you think that the Heart of Azeroth will actually be able to provide that kind of level of, okay, I am powering up, I am actually leveling, that we at least got from artifact weapons, even though artifact weapons distinctly did give us one ability, at the very least. Do you think that the Heart of Azeroth's going to give players that level of powering up when they level?
I think it'll help. I don't think it'll be as exciting as the weapon, and I think it definitely won't be as exciting as kind of what Asmongold was saying with like spell reflection. I remember back in Brynden Cure's day, I think it was level 66, and you got Ice Lance, and it was just like, 66? Dude, it might have been, I could be wrong, I think it might be 66, but I was like, dude, you know, this ability, it does triple damage on frozen targets, like I'm going to Frost Nova you, then Ice Lance, and now I can, Frost Bolt Ice Lance, like Shatter Combo is born, stuff like that. All of that kind of stuff was very exciting. So to be like, okay, I get my necklace and I get 3% more damage on my Frostbolt. I get 8% more damage on my Blizzard. You know, it's just like, it's cool, I guess, but it's not like getting a new ability that you've never used before and figuring out how to use it.
Yeah, it's not the same feeling as before.
Yeah. And it'll probably mimic kind of how we felt with the artifact weapons. Maybe a little bit less because it's a necklace instead, but it'll probably be pretty similar to that. But I'd much rather get some abilities.
Same, honestly. Yeah.
But I think that's a pretty good place to kind of start jumping in and taking these questions. I've already seen a bunch kind of flying at us. So, guys, you can start saying them in chat now as well. We'll be taking a peek there. Guys, I think that's all the time that we do have, though, right? So that's going to be it for this episode of All Craft. But Zarya, I just wanted to say it's awesome to have you back on. It's been a really long time. It's been a really long time.
You know, I really enjoyed this one. Haunted asked me, recently, and I was like, yeah, I want to go. And then all these PvP changes, I'm really excited to talk about them. I remember last time I was at All Craft, we talked about PvP for like 10 minutes and then PvE for like an hour or two. And I was so lost. So I'm glad we can talk about PvP a lot in this one, so I know what we're talking about. So I can have a little bit more info.
So other thing, though, is like with the tournaments coming back up now, going into the tournaments, I guess it starts this weekend. Yeah, I think I fly out tomorrow. What do you think as far as, do you have any predictions going into the tournament? Like what comps do you think are going to be good?
We haven't really seen too much of a change from the last tournament, so I think a lot of the same team. Actually, we've seen a lot of roster changes, so that'll be very interesting.
Yeah, even Method has had a roster change that I don't know if it's public yet, but
which one?
Which one?
No, they
I mean, Sam, I am joining.
They are public. Oh, yeah, true. Okay. Like everybody pretty much knows for the most part everything.
It's not too much of a meta swap. I think we're going to see a lot of the same things. We're going to see RMP. We're going to see jungle. We're going to see some Windwalker DK, some Cleaves. Probably a little bit less tanks since we've seen the nerf from tanks, but that's kind of all we've seen. So it's compositionally almost the same. The cool thing we get to see is all the teams, how that flushes out. I know Thuganomics made a new team. I don't know if that's public. I think it's public. He's not on the team.
It is now.
It is now. on NBOSO's team with Kolo, and he's Kolo's not with Lido anymore. Yeah, so a bunch of different roster changes. I'm really interested to see how it's going to go.
All right.
I'm excited for it as well, guys. You can watch that this weekend, and also be sure to check out Zaryu's streams. Zaryu, you're still pretty much all late night, right?
Yeah, I'm doing late night streaming. I'll be live in a few hours from now. But yeah, thanks so much for having me, guys. You can find my socials somewhere on the screen if you guys don't know who I am. PvP.
Yeah, definitely. Find him. Make sure to press
follow Zaryu on Twitch, yes. Twitter, and everywhere except for real life.
Also, please don't forget to make sure to follow All Craft Show and obviously my boy Asmongold, Rich. It's been a pleasure.
It's been awesome, guys. Yeah, and we got some stuff back in the works. Everybody's healthy again. Schedules are regular. So we're going to be coming up with a bunch of new content. I actually have a call tomorrow about some of that stuff. So, guys, stay posted on socials, and we'll also see you next week for another episode of All Craft. Thanks for tuning in.
Peace.
Peace.
Yeah. Peace.